Hey everyone, I welcome you to this new course on customer segmentation using RFM analysis. Now, before we go to the agenda of the course, I want to show you a few of our other resources that you will find useful. Our main point of access remains our website, rsquaredacademy.com. You can enroll for all our free online courses at rsquaredacademy.thinkific.com. You can also browse our R packages and Shiny apps for interactive data analysis. You can subscribe to our blog where we write once or twice every week on new topics and also introduce our packages and apps. You can find all of our open source projects on GitHub, including all the resources related to our online R courses. We also post video tutorials on YouTube, so you can subscribe to our channel and view our latest video tutorials. And you can connect with us on Twitter, Facebook, and LinkedIn for the latest notifications. Now, coming to the resources of this course, the slides are available in the learning management system as well as on our website slides.rsquaredacademy.com. The code and data used are also available in the learning management system, and we have also posted them at GitHub, where you can download the R script as well as the data set. We also created a RStudio cloud project, so if you are someone who uses RStudio cloud, you can use that link and you should be able to try out all the code that is available in this course. We have a Shiny app which we'll show in the demo section, which can be used for RFM analysis in an interactive manner. And we also have a R package called RFM, which we'll be using in this course as well. So I'll show you all these links at the end of the course after the demo section, and you can choose to use any of them. All right, so now without wasting your time any further, let me come to the agenda of this course. In the first part, I'll show you the results of a case study we will use in this course. It will show you how we proceed from the data we collect to calculating RFM score and then using them to segment customers. This section will give you a broad overview of how RFM is used for customer segmentation. In the second section, we'll explore the underlying concepts of RFM. We'll define recency, frequency, and monitor value. We'll understand how the individual scores are calculated and how they are combined to create the RFM score. In this section, we'll also look at the applications of RFM in social media, apps, and other areas. In the final section, we'll work through the case study, the results of which we show in the first section. Here you'll learn to use the RFM package, which we have developed along with the Shiny app that is part of the package. As we said before, all the data and code used in this section is available in both the learning management system as well as on GitHub. In addition, we have added a few practice questions in the learning management system so that you can try and explore this concept in a deeper manner. Now let us start with the case study. Right, so here I'm just going to show you the case study results and the steps that we'll take to arrive at the results, right? And in the demo section, we'll actually work through R code and a dummy data set that we have created to complete the case study, right? So the first thing that we need is data, right? So we need some data for RFM analysis, and that data is usually your transaction data, right? So if you look at the table here, each row represents a transaction, right? And we have the details of the customer, the date of the transaction, as well as the transaction amount, right? So this is the bare minimum that you need or require to perform RFM analysis. You need a unique customer ID, right? So this can be the name of the customer or some unique method that you are using to generate a customer ID, or it can be a combination of something like the name and contact number of the customer, right? And then you need the date of the transaction, right? And finally, you need the transaction amount. Now, the raw data might be available in this format where each row is a transaction, or it might be available at the customer level, right? So each row will represent a customer, and you will have some data related to the customer. From the perspective of RFM analysis, then what we'll require is the unique customer ID, right? Followed by the latest transaction date and the sum total of all the transaction amount. Okay, so I will show you that format in the demo section. In the RFM package, we have two different data sets. One is the transaction level data and another is the customer level data. So I'll show you the customer level data in the demo section. But for the time being, let us understand that these three details are required. That is, these three columns, which is customer ID, order date or the transaction date, and the transaction amount. Okay. Now from this, we'll generate a table known as the RFM table. All right. So here you can see, instead of transaction, we have data at the customer level, right? For each of the customers, we have three different columns of data available, right? So the first one is recency, and we have mentioned days in the bracket. So this is number of days since the last transaction of this customer, right? And the second column is the frequency, which basically represents the number of transactions of this customer. And the last column is monetary, which represents the sum total of all the transaction amounts. That's how much money this customer has spent so far, right? In all those transactions that he has done. So from the transaction level data, you have to generate this, or you have to have the data at the customer level itself, and you need all these three details. So instead of recency in days, you can also have the last transaction date. Okay, so from the raw data, we generate this RFM table where we have these three details of a customer. That is, how many days have passed since he last visited or transacted. So far, how many times he has come to our store or our website or app, and how much money he has spent, he or she has spent in all those previous transactions. Now, when we calculate the recency, that is in days, we need two dates, right? So we know the last transaction date of the customer, but we need another date to calculate the difference between these two dates and arrive at the number of days, right? So when you're doing RFM analysis, it is important to have a time frame, right? So decide on a time frame, and then you take the transaction data for that time frame, and based on that, you will calculate the recency in days. So you have the last transaction date and you have the last date of the time frame. The difference between these two is your recency in terms of days. Similarly, the number of transactions done within this time frame will be the frequency, and the sum total of all the transaction amount within the time frame will be the monetary value, right? So from this table, we generate the individual scores for recency, frequency, and monetary value, right? So now you can see that we have taken the previous table and we have added four more columns. The fifth column here shows the recency score, the sixth one the frequency score, the seventh one is the monetary score, and the last column, which is the eighth column, shows the RFM score. Okay, now from this table where we have the scores, the individual score as well as the RFM score, we are going to come to this result, right? So here you can see that we have a new column called segment, and then we have added segment for each of the customers, the segment to which they belong, right? So this segment is generated from the scores that we have created here, right? So the fifth, sixth, and seventh column, where we have the recency, frequency, and monetary score, we will use these to generate this segment for the customer, right? So this is the end result that you will be having. So we'll see this again in the demo section when we work through the case study. We'll arrive at a similar result, right? So I'm just showing this to you upfront so that it will make you more curious about this topic, and you'll have some incentive to spend time on it. All right. So now we have this outcome of the case study, and we saw the steps that we go through to arrive at this result, right? So from the transaction data, we created the RFM table, right? From that, we created the individual and combined scores, and we use that score to create segments for our customer. All right. So this is the end result, and we'll work through the case study to come at this result. But before that, we'll spend some time understanding these concepts, right? We'll understand how those recency, frequency, and monetary values generated, and how we generate the scores from them, right? The recency score, the frequency score, and the monetary score, and then how we create the combined RFM score from the individual scores, and how these individual scores are actually used to define the segments, right? So we'll look at that in this second section, right? The RFM concepts. But before we move on to the concepts, let us sort of define what RFM analysis is, right? So RFM is a behavior-based technique which is used to segment customers by looking at their transaction history. Now, in the transaction history, we are looking at how recently a customer has visited or purchased, which is his recency. How often do they visit or purchase, which is the frequency, and how much does the customer spend? Is he a low spending customer? Is he a very high spending customer? Or is he an average spending customer? Right now, how would a ideal customer look like? Right, so he would have visited most recently, say a couple of weeks or 1 month or 2 months back, depending on the domain at which you are looking. They would visit or purchase frequently, right? And they would be a very high spending customer, right? The average order value from these people would be very high, right? So we'll look at all these different types of customers you'll have: those who visit rarely but have a very high spending habits, those who visit often but are very low spending customers, right? So we look at all those combination of customers, and we'll see how we can define segments for them, right? So from there, we'll just take a quick look at the applications, right? So you know that RFM analysis can be applied in a store or in a e-commerce venture, right? So wherever you are collecting data about transaction, either using point of sale or online, you have all these data about customers, right? So if it is a physical store, there has to be a way to identify the customer. There's a unique customer ID. Probably in online, there'll be a visitor ID assigned to the customer, right? And you also store the number of visits, how much do they purchase or transact in each of those visits or transactions. Now, a few things that you need to keep in mind is that, you know, in a physical store, you only have these transactions recorded, right? So customer comes in, he purchases something and leaves. But in the online or digital world, you will have scenarios where people are coming to your website. Sometimes they purchase, sometimes they do not, right? So they might come three times, and only once they might have done some transaction, or there might be some conversion, but not in all the visits, right? So you need to really think how you're going to calculate the recency, right? And the frequency, right? Do you consider the latest visit without transaction for the recency, or do you consider all the visits for frequency, right? So that's something that you need to keep in mind. And when it comes to these other areas, right? So for example, this could be social media sites, or it could be a news or a blogging site, or it could be an app, right? It could be even be a gaming app. In all these cases, you really do not have probably the monetary value. That's a transaction amount, right? So not all of them will be selling some product or service, right? So In that case, you need to really think an alternative for the monetary value. And that would in most cases be the amount of time that these visitors are spending on your platform, right? The amount of time they are spending on social media websites, amount of time they are spending on reading news, reading blogs, or playing games or using the app. So you need to find a different metric there. But the first two metrics, which are recency and frequency, are pretty much available in all these cases as well. Now, the number of times people come will differ from a grocery store to e-commerce website to social media sites or a news website. So in some cases, they are coming probably a few hours. Some cases, they'll come once in a few days. In other cases, they'll be coming once in a few months, right? So for example, in cases of durable products, people will come once in a few months or once in a few years, right? So you need to keep the domain to which you are applying this analysis, and based on that you need to select the time frame, because if you select a very short time frame, it might not really show the number of times people are coming or how recently they have come, right? So depending on the domain, select the right time frame and also select the right metric. Okay, so now we have a good idea of what RFM is, to all the different areas to which it can be applied. Now let us come back to the RFM table, right? How we created the RFM table. This is something I showed in the case study section, right? So I'm coming back to this data again. So let us assume we have all these transaction data, right? So we have one transaction per row, and we have the customer ID, the transaction date, and the transaction amount available, right? So first thing to do is it might be available by date, right? The transactions will be available by date, or it might even be available by customer ID. In case it is not available, in case it is random, then you try to sort them by customer ID and by transaction date, right? So that's the second table you're seeing here. We have sorted this data by customer ID and then by the transaction date, right? So once you have this data set, you create the RFM table, right? You start aggregating data at the customer level, right? So from several rows, we are now having only three rows of data, right? One row per customer. Again, like I said before, you have a time frame. So you have a start date and end date. And to calculate recency, you look at the latest transaction of the customer. And then you have the end date of your time frame. And you look at the difference between these two dates in terms of days, right? So for example, let us look at our customer Lionel here, right? So his latest transaction was in June 9, 2016, right? And the analysis is being done on 31st December 2016. So the recency in days that you see here is the difference between these two dates in terms of days, right? So the difference between 31 December 2016 and 9th June 2016. Similarly, if you look at the latest transaction date for the other two customers and you use the end date of the time frame, which is 31st December 2016, you'll be able to calculate the recency days for them as well, right? So it looks like Lionel has come close to 6 months before, Jenny about 3 months back, and Taj is like around 20 months back. Now frequency is just the count of transaction in this time frame. So Lionel has about 6 transactions, Jenny 9, and Taj 4 transactions. The monetary value that you see is the sum total of the transaction amount, right? So you take the third column here, that is order amount, and then you sum it up for each of these customers. So you have 6 transactions for Lionel. You sum up the transaction amount for these 6 transactions and you will see the monetary value of 472. Similarly, you can calculate it for the other two customers as well. Now, coming back to the metrics, right? These are the three important metrics that we have: recency, frequency, and monetary value. Recency indicates the number of days since the last transaction. Frequency indicates the number of transactions or number of visits within the time frame. And monetary value is the total amount spent by this customer within the time frame. In different domains, probably in other domains, instead of monetary value, you will have amount of time that a customer is spending on your platform. Because the more time they spend on your platform or your website or your app, the more ads you can display to them and the more ad revenue you are getting, right? So instead of transaction amount, you have the time spent by the customer. Now let us look at the computation of each of these in more detail. So I'll start with recency, right? So let us look at this customer who is Taj. He has 4 transactions and we are not showing them ordered by date as such, right? So the first transaction is on 21st April 2015. The second transaction we see is 31st March 2015. The third transaction is on 10th July 2014 and the fourth transaction is on 9th March 2015, right? So you have the transaction date for the 4 transactions and you have selected a time frame within which you have taken these transactions. Now to calculate recency, you first look at the analysis date, right? So in our case, it is 31st December 2016. And next you look at the latest transaction and its date. So in case of Taj, the latest transaction date is 21st April 2015, right? Because the one transaction has happened in 2014. There are 3 transactions in 2015. 2 of them are in March, 19th March and 21st March. And the last transaction happened on 21st April 2015. So that's the most recent transaction date. We take that and then we calculate the difference between these two dates, which is the analysis date and the most recent transaction date, right? So we have these two dates. We'll calculate the difference between them in terms of days, and that is 620 days. That's close to 20 months back. So this customer is as good as lost. He has not come back in 20 months, and we need to do something to reactivate this customer, okay? So this is how recency is calculated. I will see how frequency is calculated. Right, so I'm going back to that previous table that we saw. Frequency again here is the count of transactions in the given time frame. Right, so Lionel here has 6 transactions, so that is his frequency value. Janil has 9 transactions, so that is his frequency value. And Taj has 4 transactions. Now, like I said before, if you are dealing with online or digital work, then you need to be a little bit careful here because not all the visits will result in a transaction or a conversion, right? Sometimes people will just come to the website or the platform or the app and they might not do any transaction. So in those cases, you need to think how you'll calculate frequency. Will you take all the visits and include them in frequency, or will you only take those visits which resulted in a conversion or a transaction and use them as the frequency value, right? So think about that depending on your domain. Like I said before, if the platform or the app or the website is not selling any product or services, then the metric will change, right? It will be amount of time spent on the website or the platform. In that case, you can consider all the visits, right? So for example, if it is a news website or a blogging website or something like that, or social media, then every visit will be included because they would have spent some time on the website. But in cases of websites or platforms that are selling some service or they're selling some product, then you need to think about the frequency, okay? Now the last one, which is monetary, right? Again, you take all the transactions for each customer in a given time frame and you sum up the transaction amounts, right? So for Lionel, we have 6 transactions and the total transaction amount is $472. Jainil has 9 transactions and his total transaction amount is about $843, which is almost double of what Henel has. And Taj has 4 transactions and the total transaction amount is about $196, which is less than half of what Lionel has, right? So this is the monetary value. We saw how to calculate recency and frequency. Now we'll move to a more important part of this course, right? From these 3 metrics that we saw, which is recency, frequency, and monetary value, now we'll generate scores, right? We are going to generate the recency, frequency, and monetary scores. Now, this is a part which has confused a lot of readers, even those who were using our R package or went through some of our earlier blog posts. And we had quite a few mails coming from readers asking us to clarify the way these scores are generated. So I'll be spending some time going through step by step of how these scores are generated and things to keep in mind when you are either generating this course or using these scores generated by our own package or some other package or some other software. First, I'll show you how we generate the monetary score. Okay, so once we have a good idea about how this is generated, we look at frequency, which is very similar, right? Instead of the total transaction amount or the monetary value, we'll just use the frequency value to generate the frequency score, but the steps will remain same. In the end, when we look at recency, there's a little difference, right? So I'll take it up in the last, but first let us focus on monetary score, right? So we have this RFM table where we have aggregated data at the customer level. We have the recency value, frequency value, and monetary value, right? So now we'll take up the monetary value. There's a column from where we get the monetary value, and then we'll use quantiles, right, to create cutoff points, right? So take a look at the first table. There are two columns, right? One is quantile and one is revenue column, right? And there we have the values from 12 to $1488, right? Now these cutoffs are going to help me create 5 groups of customers, right? The bottom 20% of my customers in terms of revenue, the next 20%, the middle 20% of customers from in terms of revenue, and then also the top 20% of my customers, right? So I'm going to define an interval, okay, using these cutoff points. And then I'm going to say anyone who falls within this interval will be given a score, right? That is what you see in the second table where we have an interval and the score associated with that interval, right? And using these two, that is the interval and the score, we will apply to our customers, right? That is the table in the second row, right? The big table that you see where we have the customer column, the monetary value, the interval within which this customer falls, and the associated monetary score. Now, how to calculate the quantiles in R, I'll show it to you in the demo section, right? So we'll run through the code and we'll see how it is computed. I'll also show the function, which is quantile, that is used, and also show you how you can generate this for different groups, right? So in this case, I'm creating it for 5 groups, right? I need to create 5 groups, so I'm creating those cutoff points and I'm assigning 5 scores. In a different scenario, I might do it only for 3 groups, right? So I'll say I need to create the cutoff for only 3 groups because I'm assigning only 3 scores instead of 5 scores. And also I'll tell you why we have 5 scores and when you can have different scores, right? So when do you have only 3 scores, when do you have 5 scores? So first let us look at the cutoff points, right? So the minimum transaction amount we saw in the data set was 12, and the maximum transaction amount from a customer, that's the maximum revenue for a customer in the given time frame, was 1488. Now we are going to create these cutoff points that will create 5 groups, right? 20-20%. Each group has 20-20% of the customers, and we'll assign scores to each of these groups depending on where the customer is going to fall. I'll show you how we have created the interval, right? So the first interval is less than $254.8. Let us say $255. Right, so this is the bottom 20% of my customers. Again, this is in terms of revenue, right? So less than $255, I am giving them a score because they are the bottom 20% of my customers. They are not bringing in high revenue, and that's why I'm giving them a score of 1. Okay, so the next 20% of my customers are spending anywhere between $255 and $381. Right, so I am assigning them a score of 2, right, because these are the next 20%, but they are better than the bottom 20% of customers in terms of revenue, right? So the bottom 20% had a score of 1, the second group is better than that, so I am giving them a score of 2, which is higher than 1. The middle 20% spends anywhere between $381 to $505, right, and I am giving them a score of 3. The next group, that is which is above the middle group and below the top group, they are spending anywhere between $505 to $665, right? And I am assigning them a score of 4. The top 20%, these are like my best customers, my champion customers, they are spending an amount greater than $665. So if the revenue from you, or let us say customer A in the given time frame, is greater than 665, I give them a score of 5, right? And all these scores are higher compared to the previous group. So 2 is greater than 1 because the second group is better than the lowest group, right? So the bottom 20% of my customers, right? And see how the intervals are created, right? I am, instead of saying that greater than 12 and less than equal to 255, I am just saying less than equal to 255 for the bottom 20%, and for the top 20%, instead of saying greater than 665 and less than equal to 1488, I just say okay, greater than $665, right? So from the cutoff points, we arrive at the interval. The cutoff points themselves are coming from the quantiles. I'll show it in the demo section how we compute them. So from the cutoff points, we come to the interval. Each interval is assigned a score. Now I'll go and see where my customers fall, right, into which interval they are falling or they belong, and based on that I am going to assign them the score, right? So let us look at the first one, which is Lionel. He has the total revenue from Lionel in the time frame within which we are doing the analysis is $472, right? And it comes in the third interval, greater than $381 and lesser than equal to $505. Right, so Lionel belongs to the middle 20% of my customer. So he's an, in terms of revenue, he's an average customer. So I give him a score of 3. The next customer, who is Janil, the total revenue from Janil is $843, right? And he belongs to the top 20% of my customers. So we look at the fifth interval, greater than $665. So we assign him a score of 5. The third customer is Taj, whose total revenue was $196, right? And if you look at the first interval, say anyone with total revenue less than equal to $255 belongs to the bottom 20% of customers in terms of revenue. So we assign him a score of 1, right? Now, here I'm talking about score, right? 1 for the bottom 20%, 2 for the next 20%, 3 for the middle 20%, so on, right? In some cases, people will use something called as rank instead of score, right? So same values are there, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They'll interpret as rank, right? So, and when you call something as rank, rank 1 is always higher than rank 5, right? In our case, we are not doing that. We are just calling it as a score, or you can call it as marks, which are given in exam. So 5 is always greater than 1, right? So 1 is being given to the bottom 20% of my customers, 5 to the top 20% of my customers. But if you interpret this as rank, then you'll have to change this order in which you have assigned it, right? when you say rank, then rank 1 is higher than rank 5. So you'll always have to assign rank 1 to your top 20% of your customers and rank 5 to the bottom 20% of the customers. So this order will get reversed, right? So top 20% will get assigned 1 and the bottom 20% will get assigned 5. The middle 20% will still have the rank 3, and 2 and 4 will also get changed, right? So in some cases, score rank is assigned instead of score, and you'll see it will be in reverse order, and I don't want you to get confused when you do that. It might be in some software or other places, but we do not follow that in our R package. This is the method that we use in our package, right? So you calculate the quantiles. From the quantiles, you create the intervals. For each interval, you assign a score, and then you see into which interval your customer falls, and depending on that, you assign him a score, right? That is how the monetary score is assigned. Okay, now we'll see how the frequency score is assigned. The technique is same. The only thing that changes is instead of the revenue column, we'll have the frequency column. So as I said, we'll follow the same technique that we followed in case of monetary score. But here, instead of the revenue column, we have the frequency column. So look at the first table. We have two columns, quantile and frequency, right? Using these cutoff points, we create the intervals, right? So my bottom 20% of customers visit less than 3 times, right? Less than or equal to 3 times. So they might have come once, twice, or maximum thrice. The next 20%, they have visited around 4 times. The middle 20%, they have visited around 5 times. The next 20%, that is above the middle 20% and below the top 20%, they have visited either 6 times or 7 times. And the top 20% of my customers have visited more than 7 times. So the technique is same. You have calculated the quantiles, then you using those cutoff points, you're creating the interval, and then you are assigning the score, right? So you have score 1 for the bottom 20%, score 5 for the top 20%, for the middle 20% we have 3. Now let us apply this to our sample data set, right? So Lionel has come around 6 times, right? So he's in the 4th interval, greater than 5 and less than equal to 7. So we assign him a score of 4. Look at Janiel, he has come 9 times. So he is in the 5th interval, greater than 7. He is in the top 20% of the customers. So he gets a score of 5. Taj has visited 4 times. So he's in the 2nd interval, greater than 3, less than equal to 4. So he is assigned a score of 2. Right. So this procedure or the technique is same. We have just replaced the revenue column, that's monetary value, with frequency. And because of this frequency, you will most often see that the values are in single digit, right? Unless you take a very long time frame, you might have these values in single digits, okay? Now, from monetary score to frequency score, let us move on to recency score, right? So there's a slight difference if you observe the tables here. In the first table, instead of the revenue column, as in the monetary score computation, we have replaced it with recency. That is number of days since the visitor last came to the store or the website. In the second table, we have interval and score. And in the third table, we assign scores to our customers based on the interval in which they fall. If you carefully observe, the difference is in the way we have assigned the score. Right, if you look at these two cases, we started with 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, right? If you look at the second table where we have interval and score, we went from 1 to 5 in monetary score. Similarly, in frequency score, again we went from 1 to 5, but in recency score, we're starting from 5 and we are going to 1. Now I'll tell you the reason why. Right, if you take either monetary score or the frequency score, they are dependent on the monetary value, that is the total revenue from the customer, and frequency, which is the total number of transactions, right? In these two cases, the higher the value, the better, right? The higher the customer spends, the more revenue we get, right? Similarly, the more number of times, the more frequently a customer visits the store or the website, the more transaction we have and more revenue we get. So the higher the value, the better, and the higher the value, the higher the score, right? So in this case, as the revenue goes increases, the score is also increasing, right? Because the higher the revenue, the better the customer, the better score we assign. But in case of recency, it is different, right? Because here we are looking at the difference in days from the last transaction date, right? When did the customer last visit us? Was it like 3 months back, 6 months back, or 1 week back, right? So in recency, the lower the value, the better. Because the lower the value, the more recently the customer has come, the higher the value, the customer would have probably visited way back, right? So in these, in the case of recency, as the value increases, that is, as the recency value increases, we are looking at customers who had come way back, maybe 6 months, 1 year, 2 year, right? And a customer who has visited in the recent past, let me say in last 15 days, is more valuable than a customer who has visited, let us say, 6 months back or 2 years back, right? So I will assign a higher score to a customer who has visited in the recent past compared to a customer who visited way back, right? So that is why the scoring here is different. Again, let us start with the first table, right? We have the recency in days. We use quantiles to get the cutoff points. Based on the cutoff points, we have created the intervals. Now let us look at the interval. In the first interval, we are looking at customers who came in the past 114 days, that is the past 3 or 3.5 months, right? And we are giving them a score of 5 because these are the customers who came in the recent past, right? In the past 3 months. Then we look at customers who have come between 114 days and 118 days, right? That is between 3 to 6 months, right? So we give them a score of 4, right? These are the the first row that we see. The first interval is the top 20%. These are the next 20%. And then the middle 20%, these customers came between 180 days and 296 days, right? That's between 6 months and 10 months. So we give them a score of 3. Then the next 20%, right? This is between the middle 20% and the bottom 20%. They came somewhere between 296 days to 481 days, right? So that is something like you have from 10 months to 18 months, right? And we give them a score of 2. And the bottom 20% of my customers came before 481 days, right? So it has been like more than 18 months since they visited the store or the website, and we give them a score of 1 because these customers are as good as lost, right? And so we give them a low score. Now let us apply this to our sample data set, right? So Lionel came around 205 days back. He falls in the interval greater than 180 to lesser than 296 days. So he's in the middle 20% of customers. So we give him the score of 3. Janiel came about 3 months back, that's 90 days. So we give him a score of 5. And Taj has come close to 20 months back, right? And he is in that last category interval, right? Greater than 481 days. So we give him a score of 1. So look at this. Look at the point of time when they came and the score that we are giving them, right? Janiel has come in past 3 months. He's more valuable than other two customers. So we give him a score of 5. Lionel has come in the past 6 months, so we give him a score of 3. And Taj has come almost 20 months back, so we give him a score of 1 because chances of him coming back are very low, right? Similarly, in frequency, those who have come more frequently are assigned a higher score compared to those who have come less frequently. And the same way, those who have generated more revenue, we assign them a higher score compared to someone who is a less spending customer, right? So this is the logic behind the scores that we have created: monetary score, frequency score, and recent score, right? Now from these individual scores, right? So we calculated the frequency score, monetary score, and recency score, right? So from these individual scores, now we'll compute the combined RFM score, right? And we'll show you how to do that, right? So if you look at the table, we have the customer data, the recency, frequency, monetary values, then the scores, which are R, F, and M. And then in the last column, we have the RFM score. The way we compute that is, we multiply the recency score by 100, then we multiply the frequency score by 10, and we add all the three scores. So if you look at the first row, it is 343, right? So we have recency score is 3, multiplied by 100, we get 300. Frequency score is 4, multiplied by 10, it is 40. And the monetary score is 3, so add all the 3, 300 plus 40 plus 3, that's 343. Similarly, for the second row, we have 5 in all the three scores, right? So 500 plus 50 plus 5, 555. And for the last customer, we have 100, that is 1 into 100, recency score is 1, 2 into frequency, that is 20, and monetary score is 1. So you have 121. So the RFM score is computed in this way. You might actually not really use it as such, right? When we create the segments, we'll still use the individual score, but this is there so that you know what are the different scores, right? So it doesn't change. You're creating it in such a way that it doesn't change. It is as good as concatenating them together, right? 3, 4, and 3, you should get it in the final score as well, right? So this is the way the RFM score is computed. Now from this, we'll move on to the segmentation part. We'll use the individual scores to create segments, and we'll also define the characteristics of the customers who belong to each segment, right? So here's a sample segment table, right? So first column has the segment name. So we have champion customers, loyal customers, potential loyalists, those customers who need attention, those who are at risk, those whom we can't lose, those whom we have already lost. And then we have the description, right? So for champions, we are saying, okay, these are customers who bought recently, they buy very often, and they spend the most, right? So characteristics of a ideal customer, they have come very recently, they come very frequently, and they also spend a lot of money. Now look at new customers, right? They bought more recently, but not often, right? So they come in the recent past, but they're not come very often, right? We don't have much transaction data about them. So these are new customers. Look at about to sleep, right? Below average recency, frequency, and monetary values. They come in the not so recent past, they don't come very often, and even they don't spend much money. Look at lost, lowest recency, frequency, and monetary value. They came way back, they haven't come very often, and they're the lowest spending customers. So you name the segment, and you also describe the characteristics of the customers in these segments. And then you'll say, okay, if the recency value or the recency score is between so and so, then that particular customer belongs to the champion segment, right? Since our champion customers are those who bought recently, they'll have very high recency score. They buy very frequently, so their frequency score is also very high, and they spend the most, right? They are big spending customers, so their monetary score is also very high. So we give them 4 to 5, 4 to 5, and 4 to 5. Then we look at loyal customers, right? They spend good money and they're responsive to promotions. So recency score is 2 to 4. They might have come in the recent past. Frequency, they might not be very frequent, but they have come frequently, so we give them a score of 3 to 4. But they spend good money, right? So we give them a score of 4 to 5, the monetary score. So in this way, you have to go on giving intervals for all the three scores based on the description you have made, right? So first you start with the segment name, then you clearly describe the characteristics of the customer who belongs to this segment, and based on this description, you'll also specify the interval of the three scores. So if when you say they spend good money, the monetary score should be very high. When you say they came very recently, the recency score should be high. When you say they come more frequently, the frequency score should be high. In the same way, if they are come in the distant past, then recency score will be low. For example, in case of the lost customer, recency score will be 1. If they don't come very frequently, again the frequency score will be low. So for example, take the promising segment, right? These are recent shoppers but haven't spent much. So they have a high recency score between 3 to 4 because they're recent shoppers. And since they're recent shoppers, they don't have much transaction history. So the frequency score will be low. So we give them 1. So frequency score will be 1. And the monitor score is also 1 because they haven't spent much. They come recently, but they have not spent much money. So we give them a low monitor score. That's the interval will be very low. So in this way, you have to specify the intervals for the segments, and you need to be very careful when you do this, right? So in this case, we have created a lot of segments. Maybe you don't need to do that. You can have 6 or 8 segments, and then you can ensure that no one particular segment becomes a subset of the other segment, because in that case you will not see them when you create a distribution of your customer segments, right? Some of the segments will be missing purely for the reason that they'll become a subset of another segment. Okay, and in some cases you will end up with customers who belong to the other section, right? Here we have defined about 11 segments, right? But you'll see that in the case study, when we adopt the same segmentation, we'll have lots of customers who would end up belonging to others category, right? And you don't want that, right? You want to be able to clearly segment your customers. You don't want them ending in the segment others. So we'll try to see how we can reduce that as well, right? So this brings us to the end of the second section, where we are looking at RFM concepts. I'll just take you quickly to the result of the case study that we saw in the first section as well. Yeah, the customer ID, the recency, frequency and monetary values. From that we created the scores for all the three, created the combined RFM score, and using that we assigned them to a particular segment depending on the description, that is describing the characteristics of this customer, right? So now what we'll do is, in this next section, which is the demo section, what we are going to do is we'll work through the actual case study, right? We have this sample data set. We'll work through it, we'll use the RFM package, we'll run the code, and we'll see the output, which will be very similar. And then after that, I'll also take you through the Shiny app, right? So every time you don't need to run the code. Once you understood the concept and once you know the API of the RFM package, you can also use the Shiny app, which will allow you to iterate these segments very quickly, right? You can keep changing the intervals for the different scores. You can add or remove segments very quickly and see that you have created optimal segments. And in the end, we'll also look at a few practice questions, right? So we have added a few practice questions that we want you to try and see how you get the results, right? That will we look at use 3 scores instead of 5 scores. That is, instead of 1 to 5, we'll have 1 to 3. And we also look at reducing the number of segments, right? So let us move on to the next section, which is the demo section. I'll first show you the R script that we are going to use in this demo section. And this script is available again in the learning management system, right? So you can download it from there. And it is also available on GitHub, right? So we'll share the link in the learning management system, as well as in the slides and the video tutorial on YouTube. And we have also created a project on RStudio Cloud, right? So that link is also shared. So if you are someone who uses RStudio Cloud, you can try it out there as well, right? And as far as the data is concerned, there's no separate data set that we have added in the LMS or in GitHub, because all the data that we will use is available within the RFM package, right? So the transaction level data as well as the customer level data. And I'll also show you the customer level data in this demo, Right, so first let us load the libraries that we'll use. Right, the first one of course is the RFM library. Then we'll use the pipe operator for MacRitar, dplyr for data wrangling, and lubridate so that we can specify the analysis state. Right, so we'll use these four libraries, and I'll also show you the documentation for RFM package. Right, so you can find it here in rfm.rsquaredacademy.com. We have shared this link as well. Right, so here you can go to the reference section and you can see the documentation for all the functions that we'll be using in the script. Right, and there are examples here as well, and you can also see the source code here at GitHub, right? github.com/rsquaredacademy/rfm. Okay, so let me go back to RStudio and we'll start running these code one by one. The first thing is the RFM data, right? So I'll first show you the transaction level data that we have. Right, so you can see the customer ID, the order date, and the revenue. Right, for each row here represents one transaction. Right, and there will be multiple transactions for certain customers, so they'll have multiple rows. The customer ID is the name of the customer itself. Okay, and let me also quickly show the transaction level data. Right, so it is RFM underscore data underscore customer. Right, so here you have customer ID, the revenue, the most recent visit date, number of orders or transaction. Right, and you also have recency days, so that is not visible in the console here. I will use view so that you'll be able to see all the columns. Right, so here you can see all the columns, right? We have customer ID, you have the revenue, right? That's the total revenue for this customer, the most recent visit date, so that you'll be able to calculate the recency days. If you have the analysis state, you have the number of orders or the frequency, and you also have a recency underscore day. So this assumes a certain date and it has given you the recency underscore days. Sometimes you might have the most recent visit date, or you might have the recency days. The other two columns must be there, which is revenue and number of orders, right? So you can try it with this data as well when you're practicing. We have functions for dealing with customer level data, right? So we have two functions, RFM underscore table underscore customer and RFM underscore table underscore customer underscore two, right? So that if one will have the most recent visit date and another will deal with the recency days. Okay, now let us go back here and we'll create the RFM table from this transaction data. Right, so first thing I'll do is I'll specify the analysis date, right, which is 31 December 2006. Okay, so let us first create the analysis date. We are using the lubridate package for this, and then we'll use the function RFM underscore table underscore order. Right, so this deals with order data or transaction data, right, and it will take, let us look at the documentation of this function so that we'll see what inputs it is taking, that is the arguments, right? The first input is the transaction data, right? So the first input is transaction data, and second input is customer ID, that's the name of the column which represents customer ID. Then you have the name of the column that represents order date or transaction date. Then the column that represents the revenue or the transaction amount. And then the analysis date, that's the date on which we are doing the analysis, and how many groups have to be created, that's bins, right? How many groups are you creating for recency, frequency, and monetary. The default is 5. You can change it. Try to keep the same groups for all the three, but you can also have different bin numbers or different numbers of groups. All right. So this is the documentation. You can come and view this when you are running your code. All right. So let us go back and run this. I'm going to store it in a variable called rfm underscore result so that we can use it later. Right. Let us see the output from rfm result. I'm just going to increase the width of the console here so that we can see all the columns, right? So here it is, right? It has a lot of columns, right? The first one, of course, it retains the existing columns in rfm underscore data underscore orders, right? So it has a customer ID, the date of most recent visit, recency in days, the transaction count or the frequency, and the total amount or revenue from the customer. And then it has created three more columns for recency score, frequency score, and monetary score. And the last column is RFM score, right? So we have seen how all of these are created in the earlier sections, right? We saw how the computations are done for all the three scores, recency, frequency, and monetary score, and the final RFM score. So this function RFM underscore table underscore order will create all this output for you from the transaction data, the analysis date, and the number of groups specified for recency, frequency, and monetary, right? So now with one function, we have created the individual scores as well as the RFM score, right? Now we'll move on to the segmentation part, right? So I'm going to stick to the segments that we had used in the earlier section, right? So when you're going to create these segments, first you have to create vectors which will name the segments, and then which will specify the lower and upper interval for recency, frequency, and monetary score, right? So let us go back to this segments that we had created earlier, right? So here you can see, right? So we have the segment names. So I created a vector for the segment names, and then we have the lower and upper interval values which we have specified in the segment here. So I am creating one vector for each of this, right? So the lower value and the upper value of the interval. So we have six vectors, right? And we also named them in the same way: recency lower, recency upper, frequency lower, frequency upper, right? Similarly, monetary lower and monetary upper. Okay, so once you have specified the segment names as well as the lower and upper values for the interval of recency, frequency, and monetary, you'll use this function called rfm underscore segments, right? We'll also take a look at the documentation of that function here. So in the segmentation part, rfm underscore segment, right? So the input for this function, the main input, is the rfm table, right? So here we created rfm result. So the first input that we are giving to this table is rfm result, and then whatever we created, all these vectors we created, right? Segment underscore names, recency lower, recency upper, frequency lower, frequency upper, monetary lower, and monetary upper, right? So this depends on how many segments you are going to create and the scores that you're going to use, right? So here we have created around 11 segments, and we are creating 5 groups for the recency, frequency, and monetary score. You can change this, you can reduce the number of segments, and you can also reduce the scores that you are generating. Instead of having it between 1 to 5, you can have it between 1 to 4 or 1 to 3 as well, right? So let us now create all of these vectors, right? And then we'll run it through the rfm underscore segment function. Right now, again, we'll take a look at the output from this one. I'm just going to increase the width of the console so that you can see the output clearly, all the columns, right? So I'm now calling the segments variable in which we store the segmentation result. And here you can see it, right? So you have the customer ID, right? So the name of the customer, and the second output itself is the segment to which this customer belongs. And then we have all the other output that was also created in RFM underscore table. We have the RFM score, we have transaction count or frequency, recency in days, total amount, that's the total transaction amount, and the recency, frequency and monetary score, right? So be a bit careful, ensure that you are not creating too many segments and you are specifying the lower and upper interval for all the recency, frequency and monetary very carefully, depending on whether you are going to use 5 groups or 3 groups, right? So now we have created the segments, let us look at the distribution of the segments, right? How many customers belong to which segment, right? So I'll run this code here, right? Here is the distribution, right? So we have about 157 customers at risk, 132 potential customers, 116 champions, 100 need attention. We have lost about 75 customers, 92 are about to sleep, 43 are loyal customers, and there are 17 new customers. Now, we had created 11 segments, right? But here, if you look at the output, we have about 12 segments. Look at the third segment, which is others, right? And the count is 128, which means 128 customers are in the others segment, right? And this says that the way we have created the segments, there is some shortcoming in that, right? We do not want to have so many people in the segment which we have never defined in the first place, right? So by default, when you use RFM underscore segments, all those customers who do not fit into any of the defined segments, they are in a new segment that is called other. So RFM underscore segment sees into which particular segment a particular customer goes. If it can't find any segment, then there is a residual segment called others that is created, and this customer falls into that particular segment. So here we have about 128 customers who belong to other section, right? And that is close to 13% of the customers. So we do not want to have so many in others, because we have never really defined the characteristics of these customers, and we do not know how to treat them, right? Whether we have to reactivate them, or we have to are they very high spending customers so that we can upsell or cross sell something, or we need to give them some offers or promotions. We don't know that, so we need to really ensure that this number comes down, right? And this is going to be one of your practice questions, where we'll ask you to reduce the number of customers in the other section. All right, so now we have created the segments, we know the distribution of the segments, and we also know that a good chunk of customers are actually in the other section. Now let us also look at the median, recency, frequency and monetary value of these segments, right? So when we created the segments, we said that, okay, you know, if he's a champion customer, then he has come very recently, he comes very frequently, and he also spends a lot of amount on purchasing stuff from our store or website, right? So let us start with recency. This will create a plot for you. Right, so here you can see the plot, and the way we had defined, good customers have visited recently, whereas the customers whom we are about to lose visited way back, right? So if you look at the segments here, promising, it has a very low median recency, champions very very low, right? And look at the median recency for lost customers, customers in the lost segment, it is around close to 600, which means a lot of these customers whom we have lost, they visited almost 20 months back. Can't lose them. These are customers who spent a lot of amount, but they have not visited us in the recent past. So we can't lose them because they generate a lot of revenue for us. Again, at risk, you can see that the median recency for them is very high, about to sleep, again very high, hibernating, again the median recency is very high. For all the others, right? So promising, potential loyalist and loyal customers, you can see that median recency is low compared to these other segments like lost or at risk. So this is a good way to validate the segments that you have created, because you have defined the characteristics and you will see that those characteristics are reflected here. Right, now let us see the next one, right? Frequency, median frequency. Again, let us look at the segments here, right? So champions, they visit us very frequently. So you can see that the median frequency for them is 8. Loyal customers, again, they visit frequently. So for them, it is around 7, right? Can't lose them. They have come frequently, but they have not come in the recent past, right? Again, potential loyalists and loyal customers. And you can see that new customers have low frequency, it's around 3. Promising customers have even lower frequency, that's around 2, right? Because these are new and promising customers. They come in the recent past, they spend a lot of money, but they're not visited very frequently, right? So they have low frequency, median frequency. Champions have high, loyal customers have high, again, about to sleep. They have median low median frequency because they have not visited in the recent past. Again, you can look at customers in the lost segment, right? So their median frequency is 2 because in the time frame that we have taken, they are not visited in a long time, and that's why we don't have a higher count of transaction for these segments, right? Again, let us look at median monetary value. We'll again use these plots to validate the segments that we have created, right? So you can see that champion customers have a median monetary value of close to 800, right? Same for loyal customers, right? These are people who spend a lot of money, right? The transaction amount for them is very high. Look at can't lose them, right? So these are people who come frequently, who are high spending customers, but they have disappeared. They have not come in the recent past. Look at lost customers. The monetary value is very low because there is no transaction from their side in the past, right? In the recent past, we do not have any transaction from them. Potential loyalists, again, close to 400, right? And need attention, right? These are people who are high spending customers, but somehow either the frequency has reduced or they have not visited us in the recent past, right? So you can use these three plots and you can validate the segments that you have created. All right, so the bunch of other plots also that you can generate, like heat map, bar chart, histogram, and how many customers have given one order, two orders, or three orders, and stuff like that, right? So there are a bunch of plots. You can try them. I'm not going to run all of them here. I'll let you try some of these. And one thing that if you have observed with RFM packages, that we use the prefix RFM underscore so that it facilitates easy tab completion, right? So once you run this, you should be able to see all the functions from the RFM package, right? You'll be able to see them, and also it will allow for easy tab completion, right? So now I'll move on from the script and the documentation to the Shiny app, right? Let us take a quick look at how you can use the Shiny app, because especially when you are dealing with segmentation, you will have to do a lot of iteration, and it will be easy with the Shiny app as it will allow for interactive iteration, right? To launch the app, use this function RFM underscore launch underscore app, right? So you'll see a message that it is being deprecated, soft deprecated, and it will be removed in the next release. So the app is still part of RFM package, but We have moved it into another package of ours called Explorer, right? So you'll still be able to launch it from RFM for the time being, but in future you'll have to use the Explorer package as it has all the Shiny apps that we have created. Right, so let us go to the app now. Here's the interface, right? So you can upload a file or you can use sample data, right? And the sample data comes again from the RFM package. Now, if you want to upload data, click on this one, upload file, and you can upload data from different file types like CSV, XLS, JSON, files from other softwares, data, SPSS, SAS, also any file in which you have stored this data in R, like RDS, right? So I'm going to use the sample data, right, which is part of RFM package. We'll go to the transaction data here, and then we'll click on, right, so once you click on the data, it will show, take you to the documentation in a new window, right? You can close this, click on use sample data, right? Once you do that, it will show you the customer ID, right? That's the first column, which is customer ID, shows the data type as well, character, order date is of type date, and revenue is numeric, right? And it also shows the format for the date column. So if you upload data, it will still show you all of these things. What you might want to do is rename the variables if they're not well named, and you can also modify the data types, right? All these data types are there: numeric, factor, date, character, integer, and in date itself there are several date formats, right? So our data is already in the format in which we need. The data types are all fine. So I'll click on apply changes. Right, it says, do you want to select variables? No, we want to use all of the variables. And here is a quick data screening, right? This will screen data for missing values. You can use it for verifying column names and data types. So there are no missing values in our data set. The column names and data type are fine. So we'll approve this data set so that we can use it for RFM analysis. Now again, the app doesn't know what type of data you have uploaded, so it will ask you whether you want it as transaction level data, where each row represents a transaction or order, whether it's customer level data, where each row represents transaction of a customer. The data includes the number of days since the last transaction. That's one of the columns in the data set is representing recency in days. And another option is where each row represents transaction of the customer, the data includes the date of the latest transaction. Suppose the customer level data doesn't include recency in days, but includes the date of the most recent transaction of the customer, then you can select this option. Now our data set is the transaction level data. So I'm going to click here. All right, so here we'll first generate the RFM table, right? And the unique ID, customer ID, is customer ID column, and revenue, the order date is represented by order underscore date column, revenue is represented by revenue column. The analysis date is, let's go here, it's 2006, December 31st, right? And we are going to create five groups. So the recency, frequency, and monetary bins will be five. You can modify this to four or three if you want, but I will stick with five. Right, so click on submit and you should be able to see the RFM table results here. All right, so here's the output, right? So you have the customer ID, the date of the most recent transaction, recency in days, the transaction count, which is frequency, amount that represents total transaction amount, the recency score, frequency score, monetary score, and RFM score. So this is the output that we also generated earlier when we ran the code in the script, right? So once we are done with this, the next step for us is to go and look at this heat map and other plots, right? So once you do that, it will automatically generate all these plots for you, right? You don't have to write any code, you don't have to run any code here, just create the RFM table first, and once you're done that, the heat map, right? So here you can see the heat map, right? So the x-axis represents the frequency, the y-axis represents the recency, and the monetary values are represented by the shade of the areas, right? So if you can see that, those customers who are the champion customers, they have high recency, high frequency, and high mean monetary value, right? So they come frequently, they have come most recently, and they spend a lot, right? So they are high spending customers. Let us go to the bar chart, right? Again here, you can see that it is showing all the three scores for you: the monetary score, the frequency score, and the recency score. So here you can examine the distribution of monetary scores for the different combination of frequency and recency scores, right? So now let us move to the histogram, right? This is the distribution of recency, frequency, and the monetary values, not of the scores, but of the values themselves. And then there are other scatter plots, right? These examine the relationship between recency, frequency, and monetary values. Now let us go to the more interesting part. Click on analyze here and click on segments. Right here you can specify the number of segments that you are going to create, and you can increase or decrease it here, right? Let us say we are going to create 4 segments or 3 segments, right? So that I can do this quickly without wasting much of your time. Let me start with champions. So there are anywhere between 4 to 5, right? Let me know this, and then let us look at other segments here. Loyal customers 2, 4, 3, 4, and 4, 5, right? So I'll create loyal customers who are 2, 4, 3, 4, and 4, 5. It's 2, 4. Let us make this 3 to 4 and 4 to 5, and then we have lost, right? Or let us say hibernating. I'm just going to create a few segments here, right? So when you do this, you can create as many segments. Just ensure that you're specifying the right intervals for all the three scores. Once you specify the scores, you can click on generate segments. Right, so here you can see that it again creates the result that we saw earlier: customer ID, segment, RFM score, transaction count, recency, descent, amount, right? So most of them have gone into others, right? So we have some in hibernating here, right? And we also have champions here, loyal customers here, but a lot of others, right? That's because we have defined only 3 segments. So this part will allow you to iterate the segments quickly, right? So you can play around with the number of segments, you can play around with the interval values for the 3 different scores: recency, frequency, and monetary. And also you can quickly check the output here, right? So that way you don't have to run code multiple times. You can do this quickly here. Look at median recency. Okay, right, so you can see the median recency, you can see the median frequency, and median monetary value, right? So in all these cases, you don't have to run any code or you don't have to click any button. As soon as you create the segments here, as soon as you click on generate segments, all these other outputs will also be generated automatically. You don't have to click on anything else, right? So you can try this app as well. Right, so first initially run through the code so you have a good idea about what functions are being used. You can check the documentation of the functions from the RFM website. So once you know the functions, you know what the inputs are, and then you can always come and fine tune your segments using the Shiny app. All right, so now we have gone through the code and we have also gone through the Shiny app. I want to take a quick look at the practice questions, right? So we have added a few practice questions here. So the first thing is that if you look at the distribution of segments, like I said, around 13% of the customers are in the other segment. Right, so for segmentation to be effective and optimal, this segment should either be eliminated or it should have only a few customers, right? So try to redefine the segments and try to reduce the number of customers in the other segment. So either you can redefine the segments, you can have 11 segments, redefine the intervals for recency, frequency and monetary score, or look at the second question that we are asking, right? We have defined 11 segments, try to combine some of the existing segments and bring down the total segments to around 6 or 8, right? This is your choice. Either you can have 6 segments or you can have 8 segments and see if that will reduce the number of customers being classified as others, right? Another thing that we want you to try is that the RFM score we generated uses score between 1 and 5, right? Now try to create segmentation by using a score between either 1 to 4 or 1 to 3, right? So the lowest score, RFM score, will be 111 and the highest should be 333 instead of 555. So your champion customers should have the score 333 and your lost customers should have 111 in recency, frequency and monetary scores. And then reverse the scores, right? So far we have assigned score of 5 to customers who visited recently, frequently and had higher transaction amount, and 1 to customers who visited way back, right? And who visited rarely and have low transaction amount, right? Try to reverse the score pattern and create the segments. Now, you obviously can't use the RFM package in this case, because the RFM package won't work that way. We create scores instead of ranks. So for this, you'll have to run some custom code. If you're interested, you can try this, right? You can try this and send us your code. We'll take a look at it and we can discuss it as well, right? So try at least two of these questions that we are asking, practice questions, so that you can reduce the number of customers who have been classified as others and also reduce the number of segments to 6 or 8, and try with different range of scores, right? Instead of 1 to 5 for 5 groups, create 4 groups and use 1 to 4, or 3 groups and use 1 to 3. All right, so try this. If you have any questions, any concerns, any doubts, if you are getting any error in the code, or if you are having any issue with the app, please write to us at support@rsquaredacademy.com and we'll reply to you at the earliest. And like I said, you can find all the resources related to this course in the learning management system, right? It includes the script, the data sets are available within the package. We have also uploaded the code to RStudio Cloud. We have created a project there, so you can try it there as well. And then we have added the links to the RFM package, as well as we have demoed the Shiny application, right? So you can use all of these resources. You can try it with your own data set. If you have any other data set that you find, you can try it with those data sets as well. And again, like, if you have any issues, please write to us. Thank you for taking this course. You can try our other courses as well. We have a lot of courses coming up within the next month, and we'll inform you about them. And you can visit rsquaredacademy.com for free online courses on R and also for all other offerings. Thank you.